This is one I can honestly say this was inspired by a friend who had a problem. She told me about it, and when the song's over, I'll try to remember to tell you what was true about in this song. But it's about a woman who's had the worst day of her whole entire life. Everything that could possibly go wrong for her has gone wrong. She gets woken up at 5:30 in the morning by a car alarm out on the street. Just keeps going off again and again and again just to wake her up. There's no burglary. She hopes, she looks out, she's praying to see a burglar. There isn't. It's just the car waking her up. So she gives up trying to sleep. She goes into the bathroom a few minutes earlier than normal and there discovers her roommate behind her back has been using her very expensive Vidal Sassoon shampoo and filling it up with Suave when she's not looking. Are you laughing because you have done that? Sometimes we do stuff like that. Pour a little water in the milk. Actually, water in the vodka. Nobody can ever tell that. But that's from my babysitting days. I was a bad babysitter. No, it's terrible. When they wouldn't sleep, I'd say, if you don't go to sleep, the monster's going to come in the window and eat you up, and you're going to die. I was terrible. I'm so ashamed. But anyway, I'm sorry I blabbed that. I know you think less of me now. But, excuse me? He said, I didn't think much of you to begin with. Glad I got my trusty gun with me. No, it's good. No, it's good. Don't worry, though. I don't have any children of my own that I know of. We can say that now. Isn't that sick? We can say that. Anyway, this one's having a bad day. So she goes to work, and her hair is a mess, and it's raining. She buys an umbrella. It breaks. She tries to get her money back. The vendor runs off. She gets on the subway. Car breaks down. She has to walk. She gets fired from her job. Everything that could, you name it, if it could go wrong, it did. She comes trudging home after this horrible day, and the only thing that's keeping her going is the thought of seeing the handsome face of her fiancé as she walks into the apartment because he said he had something very, very important to discuss with her. And she's hoping it's honeymoon plans. Oh, you cynics, you think it's going to be bad. She's hoping it's honeymoon plans because she wants to go to one of those places like where they film Dirty Dancing. Remember that movie? In the Poconos. Anyway, she's a simple soul. So anyway, she comes trudging up the stairs after this horrible day and she opens the door to her apartment looking around for her fiancé and he's not there. And somehow her apartment looks different. Something seems to be missing. And then she sees on the refrigerator there's a little note stuck there that wasn't there earlier that morning when she left for work. And the note is stuck up there with a little refrigerator magnet. Anybody want to guess what kind of magnet is holding that note up? A heart. Very good. That adds to the tragic irony of the story. Thank you. Obviously an English major. They get credit for coming to the show when I do this song because it's a play. Okay. Yeah, she moves aside that heart-shaped magnet. She takes the note down and she reads it. The note says, "Darling, I hate to tell you this way, but I've run up with your roommate. Signed, your fiancé." I sat down and cried. Oh, don't feel so bad. Don't worry. You're so sensitive. I sat down and cried. What else could I do? That's when I noticed that my car keys were missing, too. And so was my favorite sweater and my TV and my stereo. My whole life crumbled before my eyes. Where was I to go? That's from Evita. I ran to the supermarket in a blinding rage, craving foods I have not touched since I was 12 years of age. 'Cause not only did my man run off today, my boss let me go. I have been depressed before, but never quite this low. Yes, I guess I've been depressed, but ever this low. No. So I ran up and down the aisles of the supermarket, crying and shaking and pulling things off the shelves based solely on their carbohydrate, calorie, and cholesterol count. But I did not go overboard, just enough to get me through the night. So I threw my purchases down on the conveyor belt. They rolled up to the checkout girl. She looked at them, and then she looked at me, and she said, "Hey, lady, can't you read? The sign here says Express. I'll check you through if you have got 10 items or less. But you've got 2, 4, 6, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 things right here. If you want me to check you through, put 3 things back, my dear." "No," I said defiantly, trying not to shake. But she said, "Sweetheart, you don't need those Hostess Twinkies. You don't need that Entenmann's coffee cake. And those famous Amos cookies, let me tell you, they are grossly overpriced. Put three things back, those are the rules. I'm asking you real nice. But I just couldn't. So she took another look and she said, okay, then put back that frozen pizza and those two boxes of pudding on a stick. Just looking at all these calories makes my stomach want to flip. But I refused to back down, so she refused to check me through. The line behind me was growing longer and angrier too. The line behind me was growing longer. It was pushing and shoving and cursing and swearing too. Look, I'm not trying to make trouble, I said to her. I'm having a horrible day. Today I lost my job, my car, my TV, my stereo, my roommate, not to mention my fiancé. But she shook her head and shouted, I said three things, I've got to go. Those are the rules. Oh, please, 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 I begged. But she said no. Please, 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 I begged. But she said no. And I could see that she had started to enjoy the power trip of it all. Because then all the other cashiers in solidarity shut down. The sudden empty silence was an eerie, spooky sound. Then all the customers started screaming, especially those with frozen foods. The manager came running, he was in an ugly mood. Yes, the manager, he came running, he was ugly. So was his mood. Well, now I tried to explain to him my situation about my job and my fiancé and my car. But he didn't give me half a chance, he just said, who the hell do you think you are? My whole store is paralyzed, Alana Canna, you. Now Manhattan is going hungry because you won't follow rules. Yes, Manhattan is gonna starve tonight because of stupid, selfish, solipsistic you. I didn't know what that meant either. I didn't know why he was using such a big word on me, but it was because, you see, he hated his job as store manager. He would just sit in the back room all day, reading the dictionary, then taking the It Pays to Increase Your Word Power test in Reader's Digest magazine. I know you're thinking, what has this got to do with anything? Nothing. But I read that when you write a play, you have to do character development. So there it is. Well, I know by now I must have looked extremely pitiful. Tears were streaming down my face. He was not moved. He did not think that mine was a special case. So he grabbed me and he dragged me as I was sobbing toward the door when a deep voice whispered, I've got 7 items. I'll take 3 of yours. Well, I turned and I looked at the handsomest man I've ever seen. Golden hair, tweed suit, a bow tie, eyes the bluest green. Oh, the checkout girl was furious, but what else could she do? She checked all of her items and he said, let me carry them for you. She checked all of her items. He even paid for mine, too. Can you believe my luck? And he carried the groceries down the street to my apartment. Well, he carried them toward my apartment. Unfortunately, we had to take a detour on our way there because we came upon a very terrible tragedy. A big, tall office building had caught on fire. And a man had fallen off the 37th floor, landed and squashed right on top of this woman, and they both were dead. And this nice man carrying my groceries said to me, darn, if only she had been wearing an airbag dress. And that's when I knew I could love him. Anyway, we managed to cheer ourselves up and get over to my apartment. And he put the groceries down on my dining room. He put them on the ironing board. I still think of it as my dining room table. And he looked at my groceries, and then he looked at the dishes in my sink that haven't moved in a year, and then he looked at the Roach Motel that was moving all by itself. Then he looked at me and he said, you look like the kind of woman who should not be staying home alone having dinner all by herself tonight, which I think was his way of saying in a really sweet way, you can't cook, can you? I thought that goodbye, and he said, come on, don't stay in tonight. Come out with me. I would like to take you out to my favorite restaurant, the Quilted Giraffe. The Quilted Giraffe, I thought to myself, that's the most expensive restaurant in all of New York. I've read about that swell, fabulous place. I said, why would you take me there? You don't even know me. And I'm having like the worst day in my whole entire life. He said, well, I too am having a bad day and I must do something to cheer myself up because see, today I was fired from my job, my car was stolen, and when I came home from work tonight, I found a note from my fiancé stuck to the refrigerator with a little heart magnet saying she had run off with somebody else. I said, are you kidding? Same thing happened to me. And he said, yes, I'm kidding. That heart-shaped magnet should have been a clue. Anyway, he made me laugh for that first time that whole terrible day, so I thought, okay, I'm going to go out with him. I'm going to eat this food I can't pronounce. I'm going to drink this wine that comes in a bottle with a cork in it. I'm going to do these things. And I want to tell you, it was an amazing meal. It was a fabulous meal. It was the kind of meal you read about in Cosmopolitan magazine. Yes? It was a meal that totally, totally changed my life. The one thing will always be the same. I still do my grocery shopping in that same grocery store, but you won't find me standing in the express line anymore. 'Cause I no longer shop for one, we shop for two, you see. And today our doctor tells us that we're shopping for three. Yes, today we get the good word that we're shopping for three. Now, technically, the song could be over, but if you've been paying attention, you know there's still a couple of loose ends because this is a play. That's why I had to write another act. Well, my roommate and my fiancé, remember them? They stole my car in the first act. Well, my car broke down that night. In a blinding thunderstorm, they hitchhiked back and they had a terrible fight. They did not see that 68 Chevy come speeding around the curve. And who was that behind the wheel? Oh, that nasty checkout girl. Who knew? Another unbelievable coincidence. And guess who's sitting next to her? Her fiancé. You want to guess who that was? You've seen this play. It was the store manager, her fiancé, and they were having a terrible fight. He was so mad at her because she wouldn't check through the woman with the 13 items and paralyzed his store. And she was furious because he wouldn't let the guy pay for the 13 items, both get out of the store and escape, because she thought they should both be arrested and then executed in front of a firing squad. And when he didn't agree, she knew that they were incompatible, and she was inconsolable because she knew in her heart of hearts they could not be married. And she was so upset. She was just going to drive her car into those two strangers on the highway who just happened to be my roommate, my fiancé, and all four of them were going to die in a fiery wreck. She was going to drive the Chevy off the levee, but the levee was wet. I know, another unbelievable coincidence. But you want to know what? In my younger days, that's how the song would have ended. Everybody would have been dead, and I would have been happy. But after a little therapy, I decided to give my song a kinder and a gentler ending, and isn't that a phrase we're gonna miss? Oh, the checkout girl slammed on the brakes, she stopped in time, she offered them a ride. My fiancé fell in love with her, the store manager made my roommate his bride. And now she works stocking kitty litter in the cat food aisle. When I see her on my shopping sprees, you know I flash my sweetest smile. Hi. Yeah, we went to the quilted giraffe again last night. Oh, the moral of this story is one could never tell what could be in store for you on your local grocery shelf. And sometimes you've got to break the rules if somebody breaks your heart. And if you're lucky, love might fall into your shopping cart.